completely.
Cruise man.
Tom Cruise man.
No. Ted Cruise, Ted. Please.
That's Tom Cruise.
I'm Hollywood liberal Scientologist types.
Compared to Ted Cruz.
Yeah.
How are you? Are you enjoying all of this? Do you ever get used to this hoopla?
I don't know if I get used to it. It's a certain kind of marathon skill. And you just have to sort of do it, you know? But look, the film has been getting really, really great reactions. And so that's ultimately an amazing experience for a director. And to see that holding after Cannes, which is many, many months ago, and to see that being true, you know, different countries I visit in different ways and stuff. So it's hard to complain.
So are other countries experiencing it differently than American audiences?
Not really. I feel like it's a similar, you know, experience. I mean, I do think we'll see. So far, it's been the critical community, journalists and critics, film critics who have been seeing it the most. And they see everything, so they have a pretty wide range of stuff to compare it to. Mm-hmm. And filmgoers have yet to really start to see the film, except for those that go to film festivals. And so that'll be interesting to see if that continues in that same way, because I do think the critics who've seen it respond to it in a positively as a real piece of filmmaking, and that it's cinematic, and that it was shot on Super 16, and that it allows the audience space to kind of find their way into the film. It doesn't necessarily take you by the throat and pull you along. And those are things that, you know, certain kind of filmgoers, certain kind of critics appreciate.
So in terms of your role in it, are you the chicken or the egg to that particular kind of speed? We talked to Phyllis, who discussed the fact that, you know, the book is kind of, besides shifting time, takes its time, that it's a lingering kind of thing.
I'm the incubator.
You're just a natural, you just put the egg in and take care of it.
Well, because each stage of a film is a sort of hatching process, and you kind of have to discard the shells each step of the way to keep the metaphor going as long as possible. And yeah, I think that's pretty much the role of a director, is to stay as attentive to what he or she has in front of them at the moment, because you can't keep comparing it to the script or what you imagine the dailies were gonna look like or what you thought that performance might sound like. You have to commit to what you end up with, you know, and there are all kinds of factors and unknowns that contribute to what that is.
So how did you first hear about this as a project?
I first heard about this as a project from Sandy Powell when we were doing a little gig together for Far From Heaven at the Museum of the Moving Image. This must have been 2013, I think, but I can't, somewhere in that year, because it finally came to me in May of that year. Maybe it was the year before. Obviously, this project has had a long gestation period, so it could have even been the fall before that. But she said she'd been doing all these Scorsese movies, and she said, I think I have a frock film coming up. And she said, it's this lesbian love story starring Kate, based on a Patricia Highsmith novel. And I was at that Liz Carlson was producing, and I've known Liz Carlson for years and years. So I was a little like,
And so you then call up Liz Carlson and say, why am I not directing this?
I was really busy and with a lot of other things. And so I just sort of took it in stride and carried on with what I was working on. And then my fall kind of opened up in 2013. We were waiting on an actor for another project. And that's when they were looking for a director at that point, I guess. And Liz spoke to Christine Vachon and said, do you think Todd would read it? So, yeah.
And what did you think when you read it?
Oh man, I was really, I mean, it came to me all as a package. The book, which I didn't know, the script, Kate's attachment to the project, Sandy Powell's attachment to the project. Mm-hmm. So it was a pretty luxurious package, to say the least, when it came my way. I went off to the Oregon coast. I read the novel. I read the book. I read the script. And the novel is so fantastic. It's so unique. And it is, it shares aspects of many of her other criminal novels, in that it's festering inside a single character's mind. And the way that mind functions has similar attributes. In this case, the mind of young Therese, who's falling in love with somebody, functions in a way that's not unlike the criminal mind. And so she draws a sort of invisible line between love and crime, just simply in the way the mind works and the kind of overproduction that it undergoes when you're falling in love and you're imagining all the scenarios and the outcomes and you're imagining, trying to discern what every little sign means for you. I just love that. I thought that was so beautifully rendered. And it made me think immediately about point of view and subjectivity in love stories and how great love stories in movies, and maybe arguably in, not, in literature as well, position you with a specific party, and usually the one who's more vulnerable, the more liable to be wounded in the process. And that's definitely true with Carol. But that also changes in Carol, and I love that as a opportunity.
Have you gone into anything in recent years that this far into the process before? I
mean, no, developed not everything. At all. Not at all. Everything I've done up till Carol is stuff I've written and developed myself. Yeah. So that was new, and it felt fast. It felt like
exhilarating.
Grab your hat.
But in a good way?
Yeah, it was a good way, although I really always feel I need my, you know, time to research and sort of obsess and prepare. And I had some time, and I put together an image book for the film, which is usually how, one of the ways I start, that really does capture what the film ultimately looked like. In its references, and it was helpful to Ed Lockman, who's sort of the first person I'm making that for, my director of photography, the production designer Judy Becker. But the actors also shared it, and it was informative for them as well. It was really, it was just a way of talking about what this film is going to look like outside of language. And I think what a lot of things people say about Carol is how so much of it functions outside of dialogue, outside of the spoken word, the character, its touches and looks and glances and certain shots through glass or the way the camera orients you, that are really some of the strongest elements of the film.
So you're not a stranger to this period.
I'm not.
In your work.
I'm not.
Is it?
Although it's a different end of the 50s than Far From Heaven, for sure.
So does it help having done Far From Heaven or Mildred or whatever? I mean,
well, Mildred was the decade of the 30s, the Depression era.
Right.
And Far From Heaven was really the true Eisenhower 1950s. You know, obviously as seen through the sort of language of Hollywood filmmaking.
Right.
Circean melodrama. Mm-hmm. But the sort of beautiful artifice of the soundstage and that sort of overheated language. That was really what I was confining myself to kind of rigidly in Far From Heaven. And in this, because of the subject matter, the whole issue of point of view and who the subject is at different points in the movie, that didn't feel as relevant. I was watching films from the time and they didn't really offer ways in to me. What did were the research, the visual research, the photojournalism, the art photography of New York City in the early 1950s, which suggested this very different world than the Eisenhower 50s that we sort of immediately tag with that, to that decade. Like it was a country still figuring itself out after the war years, and definitely in some levels of distress, uncertainty, paranoia, a kind of, the city looked dirty and tired, you know, and even the color palette of the color photography process, so I was looking at a lot of color work, had a unique patina to it, a very interesting sort of soiled palette, mm-hmm. which I loved, which Ed Lockman really loved, and we wanted to bring to Carol.
So do you think there's something about looking at the past that is particularly compelling to you as an artist? Has that been, I mean, because it started, I mean, going back to Barbie, sure. it's, you know, that was period two.
Yes.
Or going back to Karen Carpenter, excuse me, who
yes.
was done with Barbies.
Yes, I knew what you meant.
Yes. I still carry that around my iPhone. Illegally, of course, because illicit material.
You carry the movie in your iPhone?
I do. I watch your Karen Carpenter story. Keep it in the iPhone.
In your iPhone? Wow.
Because yeah, every once in a while, I just like to look at it. It gives me an interesting point of reference. But
that's cool.
What is it about the past for you?
I mean, it's a number of things. You know, I think partly it is at a purely selfish level, a process where I keep learning things. You know, I keep learning about about history and customs and traditions and the film and the art and the music of a certain time. And so when I think back to films I've made that are set at different times, I almost feel like I lived during that time because you get so deep into it. You mm-hmm. surround yourself with all those elements. And so I feel like I get to time travel a little bit as a result. But I also just think that something about holding up a frame to a viewer of a movie, which period films always do, you know, sort of asks you to draw connections to the present in ways that when it's implicitly about today mm-hmm. and there's no frame that's sort of exposed, you may not have to think about or question maybe as much. And so, I feel like it makes the viewer have to think about why now? Why are we watching this movie today? What does it relate? How does it relate to my life? Who am I in this picture?
And the journeys you take, are you finding yourself drawn to whatever story comes along that kind of hits your fancy at the moment? Or are you is doing something like Mildred Peirce, where you had 7 hours, 6.5 hours to do it? A choice that, okay, I want to work in a different form and try that for a spell, or?
It varies. All those things have been true for different projects, and particularly for Mildred Peirce. You know, my good friend John Raymond, who's a writer in Portland, had been telling me, I read the James M. Cain original novel of Mildred Peirce, you got to read it sometime, it's amazing. Mm-hmm. And I was carrying it around with me and not getting around to it for a while, and then I finally had time on this trip I was taking to New York, and it happened to be August of 2008. And so the financial markets were starting to tumble, the banks mm-hmm. were folding. And I open up this novel set in the beginning of the Depression era, and it spans through 9 years of the Depression years to 1940. And it was a story of middle class identity crisis, basically, a kind of collapse of values. And who are we if we can't live the way that we've been accustomed to? The 1920s had so fully defined what middle class American life was about that crisis sort of affected the very identity, I think, of what America was. And I just love how it all was told through a domestic story of a mother-daughter and how much it was about the workplace and how much it was about domestic life, but also life in the workplace. And I thought, wow, this is something that needs to be told right now. This is directly relating to our world today. Mm-hmm. And how cool would it be to do it on TV? You know, and come right in through the living room of people's lives. And also, since that great original Michael Curtiz version had really squeezed it into the form of a sort of hybrid noir melodrama thing mm-hmm. that's so unique, the novel had so many plots and themes that weren't in that film version. It felt like it was worthy of a bigger, you know, canvas and a long form dramatic approach.
Well, it's funny because I think some people responded to it by wanting it to be more of the original.
Yeah.
And then there are people who kind of relaxed into it and realized it was something else altogether.
Yeah, exactly.
But it came in waves. It was a fascinating, and when Guy came into it, the whole dynamic kind of changed.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
it was a whole different thing. Are you political outside of what you make? And do you consider what you make political?
I do consider what I make political. And particularly, I think I'm interested in that intersection because a lot of what I make are domestic stories and films about women's lives and stories about people in homes. And I think I'm interested in that unique tradition of some directors who found those stories to be implicitly political in ways that maybe more escapist genres are not. Because they're sort of burdened by social limits and pressures and choices that we all have to make in our lives that are political, that are socioeconomic, that come from a whole lot of factors, but that speak a lot about our freedoms, basically. So in that way, I'm political even when the genre doesn't necessarily suggest overt political, material.
Well, it's amazing how it doesn't change. I mean, it shifts a little bit, but it doesn't really, when it comes down to people.
It doesn't. It really doesn't. Even when there's more freedoms available to us and, that's why I think themes of identity have stayed with my films and they describe different sort of strategies for dealing with identity or different results of identity sort of exploding on you. Notions of a kind of fixed or comfortable or secure identity falling apart through illness or through external forces, or on the other side of the spectrum, creative artists who challenge that very idea, and kind of decide to do away with or attack the notion of stable identity as artists, as creators. There's something about the fact that that remains, even when under different social conditions or different periods of time, we struggle within the confines of who we're supposed to be, and how we're supposed to behave in life.
So you stay pretty busy, but is there, you go hide and have a life
I do.
Between each of these things?
I try to, at least. I mean, for so many directors who really do manage to put out work much more regularly than I do. Lately, it's been a little more. So yeah, it feels a little bit catch up. But I live in Portland, Oregon. I left New York City, where I lived for 15 years. I loved all those years in New York. They were amazing, transformative years, and sort of the formative years for my work and my career. But I'm spoiled now by a smaller city, by the life of Portland, and feeling like I can get really physically remove myself from a certain kind of concentration of energies and professional kind of ambition.
Do you ever have the urge to dive in and just try it for try to go Hollywood for a movie or two, or?
No, not really. I mean, especially as Hollywood seems to, or the options for people who want to tell dramatic stories on film just, have seemed to have narrowed over the years. So it just seems like a harder and harder place to try to reside and find some way of doing something unique or different. I find my own, through my own sort of directives or choices, surprises in that, when I did Far From Heaven, for instance, I stuck very strictly to the, as we were saying earlier, to that language of Serkian melodrama, which is at the very best a sometimes sort of denigrated genre today, and one that I thought was as much of an experiment as other films I've done that have much more kind of combustive themes or styles. And what I found is that film seemed to reach more people and touch more people emotionally than almost anything I'd done to date. Mm. And it was a testament to how resilient that genre is. And even though we did it independently with a low budget, it was not a feature film, it reached a wider audience and more kind of a, visibility than stuff I'd made before. But to me, it was just showing that these forms, these genres really hold up. And they really speak to people and they give people a kind of active role to play, I think, in how they're received.
I think it's one of the key conversations in this time of year when we're doing award stuff that people, journalists, forget that there is this there is actually a real emotional element, and that the voters, however cynical we've all turned this into, really want to feel something, and that there are movies that get dismissed early on in the season, Carol being somewhat of a victim of that, I think, over the last few months, where people just forget that people, real people, are going to see them, even though they're 6,000 Academy members. It's a real group, you know, it's a large enough group that they're actually human beings and not some sort of machine trying to give something, you know, and they're going to feel something, and that's what people really want from the movies. Even when it's an action movie, they just want to feel.
They do. I mean, there are all kinds of different ways to feel in movies, and sometimes they lead to things that you discover about yourself or the world in the process, and sometimes they're not, and that's all right, too.
Yeah.
But ultimately, it's that way that movies do connect with people, you know, because I think some people might think of my films as too cerebral or coming from academic ideas or conceptual kind of frameworks. But to me, there's always something pulsing at the core of them. And, you know, for a lot of audiences, that has been true over the years. And Carol is a love story. So in many ways, mm-hmm. it's built for an emotional connection, or built to attract people and remind them of that side of themselves when they really are become almost pure emotion, almost blinded by their emotion. And then you learn and you get knocked around and you change as a result of being in that state, you know? And I think that's sort of what you see in many ways both characters going through the course of Carol. But the thing about the award season is, like, a year later, it's hard to even remember who won the awards. Mm-hmm. It matters very much to all of us in the industry at a certain time, no matter what side of the race you're on.
Yeah.
But ultimately, it's those films that stay with viewers and live on, and people want to return to or keep looking at. You know, that ultimately has been my ambition.
Well, I think if you ask most people, they think Far From Heaven did better at the Oscars and got more nominations than it actually did.
Right,
you know?
Right.
There's still that kind of residual interesting thing.
Yeah.
And I think your filmmaking is that there's a cerebral element when you think about it, but there's always a kind of rich emotional life to your films. I'm not there being probably the most intellectually challenging or interesting in the group.
Yeah, but it's got that music going through it. It's got that pure, visceral Dylan. You know, that is the drum beat through that movie, and the kind of urge to sort of say screw it to people who attach expectations to the artist and say, no, you gotta stay put and do that again, please, you know. He's like, no way, man. I gotta keep doing something different and keep that, you know, energetic, radical kind of curiosity alive. And he's managed to do it under the most adverse success, you know, challenges of his own success. Basically, the fate of his own success can be a, you know, contaminating thing for a lot of artists and for the artistic process in general. And he's managed to just hide and skirt and avoid, you know, in the most miraculous way.
So have you ever felt that thick finger of this is what we expect from you on you?
No, I haven't. I've never had the burden of that kind of success, you know, that Dylan has struggled through, or some of the other people I've made films about.
Well, Velvet Goldmine has actually now become a kind of, had a resurrection almost in the last 10 years of people rediscovering it.
Yeah. Yes, in many ways that's true. And finding a kind of life, an afterlife, you know, past its theatrical release, through the internet, through digital media, through slash fiction, all these ways that people found, you know, different avenues to reply back to that movie, which was so great, because that's exactly the spirit in which, you know, the kind of movies that I was looking at when I was making Velvet Goldmine were films for teenagers, films that kind of blew your mind and made you, like, obsess and play the soundtrack over and over again and try to analyze the lyrics, and, you know. I love that actually has been true for Velvet Goldmine.
So are you ultimately a filmmaker who does things that are arty? Or are you an artist who happens to use film as your medium, do you think?
Well, I think of this quote that Douglas Sirk, the great Douglas Sirk, who made melodramas in the 50s, was told by people at the time, don't be arty. And he was a Dane, you know, but spoke every language and made every film in every language before he came to Universal Studios. Mm-hmm. He was like, Artie? He said, there's no translation of the word Artie in any of the European languages that he knows. Mm. That idea is a product of Hollywood. The very idea that art and commerce have separate languages, which to me is strange. I'm thinking there's got to be some translation, but I love that. I think that's such an interesting. I never knew that was true. I don't know. I think film is this crazy thing that functions in the market, but also runs through our bloodstream. It has a visceral, you know, immediate, emotional life. And so it has this great hybrid, you know. I mean, even Freud said dreams were partly these bribes, that the narrative part of dreams were bribes that were hiding a wish inside that was being expressed through the dream. So the bribe almost becomes like the commercial part of a film to lure the audience in. So we're bribing ourselves even when we dream, according to Freud. So yeah, I think it's that happens inside us and it happens outside us, you know, and film is a great place where those two realms speak to each other.
So you don't disguise it quite as much as others would.
The fact that there's artistic...
That there's something going on emotionally besides the the narrative.
No, because, you know, when you give the viewer, like, when you push back a little bit or create some resistance to the experience or do it a little bit circuitously or cast Cate Blanchett as Bob Dylan or a Barbie doll as Karen Carpenter, the audience doesn't stop believing in the story. In fact, their powers of identification are only strengthened, you know, and maybe revealed to them at some level. But it only makes you kind of want to get in more. The curiosity is kind of turned up a little bit. So I like that thing that happens, because that's all about the viewer. That's all about the person in the dark.
Well, I think we also forget people want to do the work.
Yeah.
You know, even audiences we consider quote unquote dumb audiences or whatever.
Exactly.
They really don't want to. I mean, it's one of the geniuses of Hitchcock, I guess.
Yes.
That he gave you enough that you could anticipate and that you weren't just told everything all the time.
Absolutely.
And people like it.
People
are
like
happy.
It. Exactly. They want to figure out, that's why they speak out loud in the theater behind you. Mm-hmm. She's going to get robbed, you know, and you're like, be quiet, lady. But that's exactly what we're all doing in our heads, you know, we're anticipating.
Mm. And do you watch film as much as you used to?
I do. But I always am watching. I mean, I watch films from all periods, and I still feel there's so many films I haven't seen or directors I don't have it, whose work I don't know, and a lot of world cinema directors who I'm still catching up on. Recently, I'm planning a film that has a part that's set in 1927, so I've been watching a lot of silent films, and that's a world unto itself that is just so rich and so, so extraordinary and so sophisticated and so mature, you know? We think of it as naive, and it's anything but, you know? We can learn so much from silent film.
Well, as we go through the digital evolution right now, it's fascinating that people forget how things change. Because like, people are all excited about the idea of cord cutting or whatever, and they forget that there's this process, and you lose something when you try to make those evolutions, as in, you know, the 20s silent films lost a lot when they lost the sound.
Yeah.
You know, there's always a price to pay for making the change.
Exactly.
What you think you want.
Exactly. No, it's true. I think of that a lot when I think about, when everyone talks about the progress we've all made, gays and lesbians in America. You know, from the days of Carol to today, and of course, it's absolutely true. But there's also a lot of rich sort of secret histories in there that all minority cultures express and engage in. And so, of course, we got to move in the direction we're moving in. It can't be overstated enough that it's the right way to go. It makes the life of every kid coming out today a whole different kind of prospect. But you also lose, you know, that history as well.
I kind of feel the Coens will make the first great gay divorce comedy. Because it's got to be coming, right?
Oh,
it's
God, like, I want to see that.
Gay divorce is going to be the best thing ever.
Exactly.
It's going to be more fun than straight divorce
also,
ever was.
Totally.
But you're really, you're pretty optimistic, I would guess, at this point.
About?
Everything. The world, yes?
Well, no, I don't know if I'm optimistic about the world. I think we face some serious challenges, man. Don't you?
Yeah.
Are you optimistic?
I guess you don't, yes, in a way. I kind of feel like we're going to turn a corner at some point because we absolutely have to. Otherwise, we're done.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's not we're going to be hurt.
I'm optimistic
we're
about
gonna be
the
gone.
Fact that, you know, maybe in the United States, different demographics are going to have more impact in the future. And that's an unavoidable direction. And that's going to just change the energy in the discussion. I think we haven't yet seen the last gasps of resistance to that by a sort of dwindling what we're seeing it right now. And they're scary. And they're more reactionary than we could ever imagine sometimes. But I do think that offers some interesting new dynamics.
Should we start with Ted Cruz and we end with Ted Cruz? Somehow or another.
Exactly. Or Rubio. Just
or Rubio.
One of the Cubans.
But he's so cute.
Right?
He must be okay. He's
right.
Good looking.
Exactly.
Love show business. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
Likewise.
Tail slates.